the Dialogue Institute is a member of our planning committee, and if you see him shaking his hands at us, that means we've exceeded our minute, okay? So thanks, Mehmet. Okay, so our first reporter, tell us your name, the group topic, and then your one big idea.
Hello everybody, my name is Javier Roman, and I'm with the group How Do We Build Community with Refugees. Our final resolution was that we need to support the local groups that are already working, like Center for Refugee Services, Catholic Charities, Raices, and some of the groups that we came across during the time that we were doing our discussion. So we need to support those groups because they already have the infrastructure, they're working with those individuals. We just need to support them.
Thank you, Javier. You and your group, so working to support the organizations that are already working to serve refugees.
Hi, everybody. I'm Michael. I'm with Group 3B, The Law, What's at Stake. So we just talked about what we think is influencing laws and policies right now, and we realize that the unfortunate truth is that fear is at the basis of which is driving all the misconceptions that we have, whether that be an agenda that the media is pushing, political leaders, or even on our local political leaders for the state. So it's really breaking that idea of fear that's been facilitated for us. We need to focus not only on our state, but really in our own homes. We need to talk to our families, talk to our children about the issues at hand, help them understand that we are all equal. It was a really moving sight to see the majority of the room stand up when that question was asked, whose grandparents, whose great-grandparents, or they themselves were immigrants. Definitely, just starting at the home is what we figured that
Wonderful. Thank you, Michael, and your group, moving away from fear and starting at home.
Hello, my name is Angelica Covarrubias, and I was with the group that did How Do We Create Tolerant and Inclusive Communities, and I have my notes here. We decided that a tolerant and inclusive community is created by a non-judgmental, safe, informed, and engaged community through personal interactions, starting with ourselves in our neighborhoods and schools.
Wonderful, thank you, Angelica. So creating safe communities through connection and focusing on ourselves and our school.
Yeah, our group was 4A, which was to the fear of to misconception and misrepresentation of refugees. And we talk about all the misconceptions that people in the country have toward refugees. And we came up with reestablishing a value of welcoming community, practicing a visible hospitality, welcoming and inclusion by building relationships that need to be built into the people by overcoming fear. But one thing I want to add as a former refugee is that no one becomes a refugee by choice, but you become a refugee by circumstances. Thank you.
Thank you so much. And I love that idea of visible hospitality, creating a welcoming community through visible hospitality. Thank you, Cedric.
I'm Maria Ammerman, and I was in the group 2B, which was, how does the refugee program work, and how can I get involved? And our main concern was that there's only a 4 to 6 month time span in which the families have to become self-sufficient. So we realized that everyone can offer something to help, such as their time, monetary donations, also donating their talent or their professional expertise. We had some medical professionals in our group who were interested in helping with refugees' medical needs, and they just didn't know where to plug in to do that. Also education, somebody can become, you know, an English as a second language teacher, even if they're not, you know, trained as a teacher, there's still something that they can offer to help. And then lastly, one of the things that we thought they could offer is advocacy, just spreading the word about who are refugees, why are they here, what do they need to be successful.
Wonderful, thank you. So as we think about how we can help refugees, there's ways for everyone to donate their time, talent, and treasure. Thank you.
All right. Hello, my name is John, and I was with Topic 3A, the law of what's at stake. And we talked about trying to dispel misconceptions about how we talk about immigrants, especially using the correct vocabulary and learning the laws that describe immigrants under different situations.
Okay, so accuracy in language matters. Thank you to your group.
Okay, my name is Jane Velasquez, and I work with the group on how to create tolerant and inclusive communities. And I, as a Mexican American who's lived here all my life, I'm 70 years old. And when I first got up, when they asked, stand up if you have relatives who had come from another country, and being of Native American blood, and me and Mexican American, and my mother telling me that we were always from Texas, and maybe the border kept on jumping around and it moved around us. So it got me to thinking that how could I, as a person of Mexican American descent, feel like I'm an immigrant, because they're still telling me to go home, to go back to where I came from. And so I feel like, how can I be here telling people how to feel, to welcome people, when I myself do not feel welcomed? And so we're saying that we have a long way to go. We need to continue this conversation outside these doors. We have to have courage and open up and be open to education. We have to treat people as people. Mindfulness, self-awareness, and be in the moment.
Thank you, Jane, and thank you to your group for coming up with great solutions.
Hello, I'm Jessica, and I'm from Circle Topic 4A. We did Fear of the Other, How We Overcome Misconceptions and Misperceptions. And I think we discussed that it's important to engage and educate across multiple levels, so the national, the community, and the self. National level, of course, that would be getting in touch with politicians and encouraging them to perhaps change policies. The community level, more events like this, other events that reach people across the community, perhaps those who are not like-minded, because at events like this, we're going to have more people who feel the same way we do, but we need to combat and overcome misconceptions and misperceptions, which means reaching out to people who think differently from us. So we talked about different ways that we could do that, such as cultural events across the city, like Eid and Diwali and the Day of the Dead festival. And then on a personal level, inviting those who are perhaps refugees or immigrants in our neighborhood, or volunteering at a local refugee center, or teaching English, or if somebody mentioned, just if you're at HEB and you see somebody who looks like they're struggling, who they might be new to the country, just reaching out to them, smiling at them, and letting them know you're a friendly face, go miles and miles and miles toward making that people, that person, feel more at home.
Wonderful, thank you.
Hi, I'm Michelle. Okay, ours was Circle Topic 5B, How is Entrepreneurship and Leadership by Former Immigrants and Refugees Changing the City for the Better? And we're talking about how vibrant it makes the city whenever we have new businesses being opened up, and how good for the economy it is to have people come and open up new businesses, and to have these different cultures in our city. And we talk about the things that we can do to help people who come to our country and to our city, to help them open these businesses if they want to. One of the big things that we were thinking about is having a central resource for small business startup and supporting multicultural type of businesses. Someplace where we can tell people, well, this is where you can go to get a small business loan. This is where you can go to get this, find people to employ and things like that. Also, positive support for refugees and countering fears with rich contributions, people stepping up to help the refugees whenever they need it, especially other business owners who have already been here for a long amount of time. Invite helpers and supporters of refugees to participate and show by example.
1B, so let's say, how do we build community with refugees? And we brought up the common theme of all of our discussion is language, how already difficult things for English speakers is magnified by 10 for people who don't speak English.
Yeah, so one of the solutions that we came up with was more opportunities for English practice, including conversation clubs. We had like a weekly conversation club that folks could go to and speak with refugees who are practicing their English. That would, one, help them practice their English, and two, help overcome fear of the other and misconceptions and misperceptions of refugees as folks who are only worthy of you know, service acts and not full human beings in their own right.
Okay, wonderful. So creating connections through English language, finding opportunities. I want to thank all of our reporters for coming up and summarizing what was an amazing and rich hour-long conversation in a very short amount of time. So let's give our reporters all a big round of applause.